Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann. The Middle East, in the world of oil, is best known as a producing and exporting region, and quite rightly so. It's home to some of the countries with the world's biggest oil reserves and some of the most significant exporters to world markets. These are also countries that rely on oil for up to 80, even 90% of their revenue, so it is their lifeblood. But there's something very interesting happening on the consumption side in lots of countries in the Middle East. Consumption is rising so fast that it could even jeopardise future exports if left unchecked at current rates. Joining me today for a really in-depth look at the Middle East oil story, and indeed general energy story, I have Margaret McQuaile, senior correspondent here in London, and Stuart Elliott, managing editor for News in Europe and the Middle East and Africa. Thank you both for coming. Margaret, perhaps we could start with an overview of energy consumption in the Middle East. So as I said, we think about it as an export region or a production region, but let's have a look at consumption.
Yeah, you're right. We do think of the Middle East as the powerhouse, the energy powerhouse of the world, certainly the oil production powerhouse. But the Middle East consumes a lot of energy as well. And energy consumption has been rising across the entire region. Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Qatar, the UAE. And let's take Saudi Arabia, for example. In the 1970s, energy consumption, total energy consumption, was about 20, 25 million tonnes of oil equivalent. Last year, 220 million tonnes of oil equivalent. That is pretty fast.
And it's not just in power generation either that demand is growing across the region. All of the countries in the Middle East are looking to build new refineries. Saudi Arabia itself has three refineries under construction. They're all 400,000 barrel a day plants. Most of them are for exports, so they're going to be exporting products instead of crude, but that still shows that there's going to be a shift in crude supply patterns across the world once these refineries are up and running. The first one, actually, at Jubail on the Persian Gulf, is pretty much ready to go. It started processing crude already. The first exports of products are going to start as soon as this month. Also in Kuwait, they're planning to build a huge refinery, a 615,000 barrel a day plant. It's been delayed by politics and various infighting in the country, but if that comes on stream, you know, that's going to take up a lot of Kuwait's crude. There's also a refinery planned in the UAE at Fujairah, a smaller plant. So you can see that these countries are looking to process more of their crude into high-value export products, which can sell for more than the crude. And there's also Iraq. Iraq, people don't think of particularly as a refiner, but they want to build four or five even brand new refineries across the country. They are having some trouble attracting investment to do that. People, I think, are waiting to see how things evolve in the country because it's still struggling with increasing its production. There's still problems with infighting politically, and also, you know, there's been an upsurge in unrest and violence in the country. So I don't think we're going to see any international investors going into Iraq anytime soon to build these new refineries, but it's on the table. It's what the Iraqis want to do.
Perhaps we could come back and have a bit more of an in-depth look at Saudi Arabia, Margaret. Particularly what's happening on that, what's the trend for production versus exports versus consumption? How's it all fitting together?
Well, production is going up. They're producing about 10 million barrels a day at the moment. Exports are going up too, but very interestingly, the Saudis have been burning a lot of crude directly in their power plants. And it's a trend that they're obviously trying to stem through development of gas reserves, but they have been burning quite a lot of oil directly in power plants, which isn't something you really want to do. You'd rather export it.
Yeah, so I guess that must be the main impetus behind the drive for gas exploration in Saudi Arabia. Obviously, if they can find and produce more gas, it leaves more oil, more very valuable oil available for export.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, the trend is quite clear. I think Saudi Arabia is already a big gas producer. It actually produced more than 100 billion cubic metres last year, according to BP's estimates, which is very significant, even on a global scale. But there are no exports. It's all consumed domestically.
Exactly. Yeah.
Is this search for gas, Stuart, is this something you've seen in other countries in the region? I mean, the dynamic seems to make sense in order to free up oil for export.
Yeah, in fact, it's a growing trend. Gas development in the Middle East is something that pretty much all of the countries there are looking to do. You mentioned Saudi Arabia. Yes, they've been producing a lot of gas, but they want to produce more to reduce, as Margaret said, the impact of having to burn crude directly in power plants. They want to be able to burn gas instead to export the oil. The UAE, they've started a big kind of campaign to develop more gas reserves, including sour gas. They've started quite a big program of exploration for sour gas. They've brought in Shell and Occidental Petroleum from the US to help them. And Kuwait is another country you wouldn't think of necessarily as gas rich, but it has big reserves, about 2 trillion cubic meters, all up in the north of the country. But they haven't really developed any of it, and Kuwait and the UAE, for that matter, are both actually gas importers because of the growing demand for gas in the country at the moment, in the countries. Another thing you wouldn't necessarily think of when you think of these countries in the Middle East is shale gas, unconventional gas. We've known and seen the impact of development of that resource in the US and in Canada has made a dramatic difference to those countries and their energy mix. But there is big shale gas reserves in the Middle East too. It's not that well known yet how much there is. In Kuwait, they've started trying to study some shale gas resources they have. Some experts think that if they develop just the shale gas alone, they might even be able to reduce their imports to close to zero. The UAE has started a shale gas exploration campaign as well, and so has Saudi Arabia. So they're all looking for gas, and it's not a surprise when you think that they're trying to develop gas-based industries. The UAE in particular wants to have a big petrochemical industry, and gas is an important feedstock for that. So they're really looking to develop more and more of their gas. Some of these countries export gas. The UAE has an LNG terminal, but they're still importing gas too. It's to do with geography. But the fact is that gas is going to become a major part of their energy mix going forward.
It's interesting. In the medium term, it seems clear from all those efforts underway in different countries, they're trying to boost gas recovery and to keep that, the kind of knock-on effect will be they keep that critical role they have as exporters to the world oil market. I mean, they're clearly very important to them. But closer to home, in timescale right now, a few countries, there are lots of supply disruptions coming from a few countries, not just in the Middle East, but there seems to be a lot of problems at the moment with oil supply of one form or another.
Yeah. I'm going to go slightly beyond the Middle East region, take in West Africa, North Africa, Libya. Production has plummeted. There are all sorts of disturbances, people protesting about lack of jobs, militia going into action around oil installations and so on. Anyway, Libyan production had recovered to around 1.4, you know, after having fallen virtually to zero in 2011 during the uprising. And now, because of these protests and disturbances, has gone way, way down. And some estimates put current production as low as 150,000 barrels a day, something like that. And so that's Libya. And it produces, you know, lightish crude, kind of crude that sells into Europe. Then we have Nigeria. And we talked about shale gas, a few minutes ago. Shale oil is a big issue for the Nigerians because Nigeria had a huge market in the US, huge for them. But the shale oil produced in the US is just closing the market off to Nigerian volumes. Nigeria, of course, has its own politics-based oil disturbances, sabotage, and so on. So Nigerian production has gone down. And then, of course, Iran, a Middle East producer, under sanctions. And the oil sanctions imposed about a year ago by the US and the European Union has resulted in Iranian exports dropping by more than 1 million barrels a day. And if we think back to the beginning of 2012, just taking those three countries, Iran, Libya, Nigeria, combined they were pumping around 6.6 million barrels a day. Jump now to August 2012, and they're about 1.5 million barrels a day lower collectively. So that's quite a lot of oil to lose.
That's an awful lot. Who's making up for that?
Well, the first country that springs to mind obviously is Saudi Arabia. They're the only country really in the world that has any spare capacity, any ability to boost production to meet extra oil demand globally. And they have. They are producing, as Margaret said earlier, more than 10 million barrels a day. In fact, the IEA yesterday said that they had reached a 32-year high of 10.19 million barrels a day. So that's a phenomenal volume. The spare capacity has been cut down to just over two. So you could argue the market's quite tight because of that. But at the same time, with the US shale boom, it looks like the markets are fairly well supplied despite the loss of Libya, the fall in volumes from Iran, and the disruption in Nigeria. So we're still looking at a relatively stable market.
And what about Iraq? I mean, Iraq's a country where we hear a lot of stories about ambitious plans to grow output and exports of oil, but not without its complications too. I mean, they've revised their targets down. It's very hard to see what's going on there right now. We've seen production the last couple of months going up and then down a bit.
Yes, Iraq is a strange one. It was growing quite quickly and then it kind of tapered off a little bit. And the big issue that's been surrounding Iraq in the last few months is its exports around now, because they are trying to install new equipment, new metering systems at their main southern export terminals. There's been some confusion about whether this would take an awful lot of oil off the market. There was some suggestion that up to 500,000 barrels a day could be off, could fail to load from Iraq in September. We found out yesterday that the work has actually started now on the system, installing the new infrastructure, and loadings are expected to be hit as a result. So as well as Libya and Iran and Nigeria, Iraq is exporting much less crude. Now with maintenance, you never quite know what might happen. It could be extended, there could be problems, it could be delayed, and we could be facing a loss of Iraqi barrels well into the end of this year.
I think maybe the last country I'd like to touch on, Margaret, maybe this is one for you, is Iran. I know you follow Iran very closely. Because of the sanctions, which you mentioned earlier, Iranian production and exports have fallen a long way from where they were, certainly over 1 million barrels a day. But is Iran a country we should look at as a country, because of the sanctions, we can expect further falls in supply, or is it actually somewhere that could be a source of additional oil to the market?
Interestingly, Iranian production and exports seem to have stabilized around about 2.7. People have different estimates. But there is a new government. If sanctions were to be lifted, and obviously we're not talking about the day after tomorrow, if sanctions were to be lifted, you could have a very different outlook for Iranian oil. It would depend, obviously, how quickly they manage to bring production back up again. But if you were looking at an extra 1 million barrels a day coming on in the not very distant future, that's a lot of oil. And of course, they do have massive reserves.
Well, I think we've got a very complicated picture, but you've done very well to make it clear to us. We've sort of analysed the long-term trends. I particularly appreciate the insight on the power consumption, which isn't something we always see very much from the Middle East. And your thoughts on the current supply disruptions, as ever, very welcome. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
That's all from this edition of Commodity Pulse.
Thank you.